Satsang is a lot like golf. You get on the first tee, you hit your first drive, and you don't know how the round is going to go. You just, off we go. Like that. There's a bunch of squirrels. I'm surrounded by squirrels, and they're feasting on walnuts right now. They're dropping little pieces all over the place constantly. So they are gorging right now. Maybe they feel that there's going to be a strong early winter. It's the time for them to get going on fattening up. Just like that, I'm trying to put out as many videos as possible right now, so that we can get through all this before the winter comes, as it were, the time of darkness comes, that we're hurtling towards. The train is on these tracks. If you look up ahead, you know, let's say you're on a train and you had some sort of connection to a satellite, and the satellite could beam you pictures of where the tracks were going, so you could see where the tracks are heading. It's kind of like that. If you can, it is possible to see where the tracks are going further than just, you know, your eyesight. And so if you know basically where the tracks are headed, then you can give advice. And the tracks are not headed in a good direction in the world at all. The prophecy that was given out in the Bible is turning out to be quite accurate, actually. And it seems to be coming very, very, very true. And of course, in that it said that if those times were not cut short, there wouldn't be a single living thing survive on this planet, which means that there is going to be quite a situation coming up here. Now, it's been said that you do not want to leave this planet with a return ticket. You don't want to leave this life, the body, with a return ticket. You do not. The whole goal of all of this is that so you don't have to come back. You don't have to be born of the flesh again. Identify with the flesh again, ever again. You don't have to take corporal birth and spend your time in this in nature existence. I was listening to one clip on YouTube last night, and it said that the narrator said everything we humans have ever learned has come from nature. And I said, what? Everything that's being talked about here is being learned, has come from the divine realm, hasn't come from nature at all. So everything that is true does not come from nature. Everything that is false comes from nature, actually. If you want to know the truth about nature, nature cannot tell you that. Cannot, because it didn't make itself. Okay, we made nature. Nature, it doesn't even know what its purpose is. It's like an automaton, really. But we have the secret. We know what the purpose of nature is. We keep waiting for nature to reveal it to us. Nature cannot reveal it to us at all. We have to allow divinity to reveal it to us, what the purpose of nature is. And through working my entire life of now 56 years, just always being focused on, you know, getting this answer out to the world, I've been able to now very much streamline it and simplify it and get it out to the world. Again, nature is a hypothetical scenario that we as spirit are imagining, and it's an attempt to through some process construct, manufacture power of negation of reality. And we're trying to make this hypothetical of death, of loss, of destruction, of negation. We're trying to make this hypothetical real. We're trying to transmute it into, so it becomes real, a real power instead of a hypothetical power. And then we're going to use this power to threaten the Prime Creator with the destruction of reality unless the Prime Creator changes reality for us and makes us Prime Creator. So that is the purpose of nature. It is simply the process of generating loss. Okay, we believe that we're accumulating loss throughout all history. What's happened in the universe? Loss, destruction, decay. Everything that has arisen has also been, you know, decayed and been destroyed and been lost. And so we're accumulating all this loss, and we believe if we get enough of it, we'll reach critical phase, and that somehow we have to catalyze it. You know, when you have like a resin, and you want that resin to harden, or you want some cement, you want it to turn some concrete, you want it to harden, you pour a catalyzing agent into it. Like for cement, you would put in water, and that seems to catalyze it. And in resin, you put in some type of catalyst, some chemical that hardens it up. So in existence, we are looking for a catalyst to somehow transmute the hypothetical scenario of loss, negation, death, into a real power of negation. We can then wield against reality and force the prime creator to change reality for us. So we're looking for that catalyzing agent. And what we do, we're constantly seeking catalyzing agent, because we say, wow, we've been working at this loss. We've built up so much loss over the eons, you know, billions and billions and billions of years. We've been building up all this loss in so many different ways. And we say, now we have to finish it off. And so we have to find that catalyzing agent, which is going to transmute it. So what have we done? We have set up a whole scenario here on this planet Earth where we have made it possible to bring in 7 billion bodies of flesh here. Massive infrastructure, right, of the world here. All these buildings. Huge amount of evidence of what we call life here. And we've set that all up now so all that can be collapsed. The whole thing can be collapsed. All the lives, the bodies here, all die. Everything succumb to destruction and death. And we believe that by doing that, we will catalyze, that will be the catalytic agent, which will transmute this hypothetical of negation, this hypothetical imaginary scenario of negation, that will catalyze it into a real power. And then we will then be able to go to the prime creator of reality and say, look, we have a power over you, over reality. We can destroy it. And we just want you to change a little bit of reality, just a little bit for us. And if you do that, we won't destroy it. So that is what existence is. Now, will nature ever tell you that? Will nature ever tell you that? It won't tell you that. However, it cannot hide this from you, because you can look at nature and just see what's going on in here. And you see all the cycles, et cetera, et cetera. And you can say, wow, you know, it just seems like this nature's continuously generating loss, continuously. It builds up forms to tear the forms down. And so, but it the nature itself cannot connect the dots for it. You have to do that. And you have the capability, the power to do it, because there's that which in you was not born of nature. It's created by divinity, by the prime creator. What you are, your identity, was created by the prime creator. And you that has the capacity to know everything, including to know what you did to give rise to existence, that you chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator. You wanted to be prime creator. And that gave rise then to this hypothetical scenario of loss, trying to develop a power that could force the prime creator to make you the new prime creator. So that is what we have done. And we can see that. We can know it. Whereas nature can never tell us that. Never. Nature arose from this idea of wanting to be prime creator. And nature is a hypothetical scenario. What does a hypothetical scenario know about reality, about the actual? It knows nothing about it. Nothing. Zero. So nature knows nothing about truth, nothing about reality, and can never ever inform us truly about it. It cannot hide what it is doing, so you can see it. You can see it. And of course, the pages of history are just blatant evidence of what's going on in this world and the various dynamics. So what we need to be informed is not through anything by nature, but through what is transcendent of nature, what is real. And we have within us what is real. And we can really see then. And we can see what's really going on here. And we can see how to really get free of it, which is to pick up a different idea. Exchange ideas. Exchange causal agents. Choose new idea. Choose the idea of not wanting to be prime creator. And then that idea won't give rise to any hypothetical situation of loss or negation. It will give rise to a it'll rise to a fact that is an equal overlay, a perfect, flawless, equal overlay, unconditional love, seamless overlay that's not changing at all. It's just still and quiet and beautiful and tranquil and calm and unchanging. That is what will arise from that. And we can do that. See, we're relying on nature to guide us instead of realizing we're the ones who need to make the choice, not nature. Nature can never make this choice. A hypothetical cannot choose a new idea. Hypothetical is an effect. We are the cause. We, spirit, created like the prime creator, meaning we too can create and be the causal agent. It's just that we cannot create the prime creator. We can't be the causal agent of the prime creator, but we can be causal agents. In other words, choosing ideas that we want to experience and having those ideas be presented to us. But the effects of those ideas, those effects cannot choose a different idea. They cannot choose which idea to serve. They cannot. So we are expecting nature to help us, to heal us, to choose a different idea. That'll never happen. Never happen. That's putting the cart before the horse. Won't go anywhere. We have to choose. We have to realize nature will never give us what we really want. It's only giving us loss, and that loss will never be transmuted into an actual power. Just a hypothetical loss. Symbols will never be real. Symbols will never be what they actually stand for. The actual thing they stand for. No, symbols will always be symbols. Hypothetical will always be the hypothetical. It can never be other than that. So we're waiting for nature to reveal something to us. It will never happen. Rather, what we do is we choose a new idea, and all of nature is overlaid by this unconditional love, equally distributed everywhere, unchanging, shared perfectly, and that is then what we experience. And then that experience is very easily translated back to the full awareness and participation in reality. Total reconciliation becomes very easy at that point. So again, we have to emphasize that this whole thing about nature, most people in the world have got that backwards and got it all wrong. And there are terms for that. That's called paganism, humanism, all of that stuff. Worships nature. Believes that nature is what gives us truth. Nature is what informs us of what is true. That we're a child of nature. That nature gave birth to us. All these things. Totally false. That is all simply following the hypothetical scenario and hoping to bring about a catalyzing situation that will make it real for us. And we're headed towards that catalyzing, attempted to inject the catalyst. The sacrifice of this planet is an attempt to inject the catalyst into the hypothetical scenario, which will catalyze it all and become like a real power that we now can wield and threaten the prime creator with. But the truth is, nothing will happen. We'll go through this sacrificial event that's supposed to catalyze everything, and nothing will be catalyzed. Nothing. Same old, same old. You know. And yet we are willing to do that. We're willing to sacrifice anything to get that catalyzing activity that we desperately are seeking for that, searching for that. So we fill an entire planet up. You know, the whole planet is dying even as we speak right now from all the activity of so many people on the planet. Food sources are getting polluted with the ocean, the air, the land, overuse of everything. People are getting so sick. You know, the whole situation is crumbling down around our heads and will suddenly collapse around us very rapidly. Suddenly collapse. And that's, again, to produce a catalyzing effect on this hypothetical that we call nature, the universe, and make it real, make the power of negation real. But the truth is, there is no such, we were not created to create powers like that. We didn't set out the outline of reality. We didn't set the parameters. We have no power to create power, so we cannot ever find a way to catalyze the hypothetical into the real. We cannot do it. It's impossible, totally impossible. And yet there are many, many, many who believe it will be done. And they think that their belief, they think that truth is at the mercy of belief. As if the actual is at the mercy of the hypothetical. And that just through belief that somehow it's going to happen. So that is a very simple message that I'm sharing with you, that was shared with me, and I'm sharing with you, sharing this, is that that will never happen. It can never happen. Truth is not at the mercy of belief. The actual is not at the mercy of the hypothetical. We're pursuing a path of futility, of impossibility. And the teaching is really that simple. If you can accept that, intuitively accept it, then you really know what you need to know. It's this whole plan that we've been following doesn't work. It's never going to work. And if it's never going to work, that of course that opens the door for you opting to choose a new idea, right? If you see that the path you're going is never going to give you what you really want, then of course you're going to say, okay, what will give me what I really want? You'll do that. That's it. Teaching is very simple. Either God can change reality or God cannot change reality. Either the hypothetical can be made real or it can't be made real. These are either or situations. Either or. It's either one way or the other way. There's no two ways about it at all. And so seeing there's no two ways about it, that automatically sharpens your attention and your choice-making ability. It brings it into focus very sharply. Whereas if you keep thinking, oh, maybe there's two ways and we can somehow do both or integrate both, or you're doing the shell game like this, you know, and you're moving all this kind of thing, and you think that somehow if you just do the shell game long enough, you know, boop, you know, transmutation will happen. No. No, there's nothing there. We're moving all these shells around like this, that, you know, and is it there? No. I mean, move around. Is it there? No. Move the shells around there? No. Move the shells again. Okay, here? No, it's not here. But if you turned over all the shells, instead of just one of them, you'd see there's nothing under any of the shells. Okay, you've seen that, the street game of the, you know, the shells moving around. And you assume there's something under one of the shells, but, you know, in that game, they always show the what's under there. And then they move around and say, okay, where is it? But in existence, we're moving all these shells around like this. And we keep showing, well, there's nothing there. And we're assuming that under one of these shells there's something there. We just can't pick the right one. Every time we pick, we turn the shell over and there's nothing there. There's nothing there. We say, wow, that's really clever. I got fooled again. No, turn them all over and realize there's nothing under any of those shells. Never has been. That's the shell game that's going on in existence. There's no there at all. There's no hope there at all in existence. The goal will never be realized. So this is the type of teaching that really I feel is helpful. And I wish there was more in the world, you know, like this. Instead of just, you know, being all compassionate and loving and nice, it seems like there's certainly a strong place for this type of teaching. It says it's either this or that. Either it can be transmuted or it cannot. If it cannot, okay, then you're in the driver's seat, because you've seen it and you've realized it and say, okay, I can never find what I really want. It will never take place. So I really better than make other plans, meaning focus on choosing a different causal agent, a different idea. And then that will lead to what you really want. Not so difficult. Not difficult to understand. It's either or. Either God can change reality or God cannot change reality. If God cannot change reality, no matter what, why are we in the first place desperately trying to develop some power that can force God into changing reality if it can't even be changed at all. Waste of time that way. And then two, we cannot transmute a hypothetical into a real, so it's impossible that way too. So we got like a double impossibility that we're pursuing. And that's not very smart. But we have turned our creativity, the natural creativity of mind. See, spirit chooses ideas, mind presents ideas. Mind is infinitely creative. So this natural creativity of mind has been turned towards shrewdness instead of creativity. So existence is very shrewd, very clever, very ingenious, very duplicitous, very deceptive. And all sorts of defenses and tricks and means, etc., are used to keep us feeling like we have to stick with this hypothetical scenario, that we must succeed. Otherwise, we'll be excluded from the new reality that's supposedly going to take place when we're prime creator. Or looking at the fact that we will never be prime creator, so there isn't going to be any new reality. Therefore, there can't ever be any exclusion. It's not possible. So all these defenses, we're not insane. We're very shrewd. But shrewdness never can accomplish the impossible. But what our shrewdness does is it makes us think it's plausible that we can accomplish it. It's plausible. But that's all it ever will be, is plausibility. It's plausible. So all we are left with in existence is a feeling of plausibility and shrewdness, surrounded by very, very clever shrewdness. Everyone here is very shrewd. Existence is very shrewd. Existence produces this shrewdness that we call life, personalities, people. Existence, of course, is making all that up. It's mind that's doing all this, but we're the one that we're in charge, and we're the driver of the car. The mind is like the car. We're the driver of the car. We're determining where the car goes, and the wheels of the car and the engine, you know, is doing all this stuff. So mind is doing all this stuff, like a car, the engine, the transmission, the wheels, the air conditioning, the radio, all this stuff is going on. That's like mind. And yet we are the driver of the car. That's like spirit. We determine, you know, where we're going, what car we're driving. Like that. So we, as spirit, need to choose a new idea. Mind cannot do that for us. Mind is not the chooser of ideas, it's the presenter of ideas. So existence can never do anything for us. Never. It's up to us to make an exchange. Choose unconditional love that will overlay existence for us. But we need to do this quickly. Keep advancing toward it rapidly, because the belief, you know, we're being undermined by the pagan belief system, by this belief system that believes we were created by nature, and therefore we have to follow nature's ways. Well, nature's ways coming up are going to be highly destructive. You know, we don't have to follow that. We don't even have to have our body follow that, because our body ultimately arose from our choice to try and be prime creator, just like nature arose from that too, all of that. So really, we have the right to preserve our body if we want to. Nature did not really create anything. Nature hasn't created anything other than through our own orders to do so. And so we can change our orders. We're not obligated to nature in the slightest bit. No one's obligated to nature. There's no contract that we have. In existence, the truth is there are no valid contracts in existence whatsoever. None. Zero. None. No valid contracts in existence. Not a single one in any way, shape, or form. Cannot possibly be, because the goal of existence is futile. It's impossible. So nothing here, nothing in existence is legitimate. Nothing. And yet we're full of these feelings of obligation. Full of them. Full of it. I feel guilt. If we don't fulfill all these obligations and live up to all this stuff. But none of them are valid. All entered under false premise, false pretexts. which means that they're null and void at the very beginning. We should just annul. All contracts are hereby annulled. They've always been annulled. They've never valid in the first place. Doesn't matter how much we sign here and sign there and sign there. All null and void. Therefore, we can do what we want to do with the body. If we want to move to a safe place or something like that, that is perfectly fine. We're within our rights. We don't have to follow the directions of nature. Not at all. We can follow the divine intuition, the directions of the divine, of God's grace. We can follow that. It's non-sacrificial directions. And we can flee the massacre. Absolutely. You have the right to flee a massacre. Absolutely. You don't have to practice sati, you know, like the widow whose husband has died. You're having to climb onto the funeral pyre, the fire, and be burned alive with the husband and the cremation fire. You don't have to do that. You don't have to go down with the ship. And the threat that if you don't do that, you're going to be excluded from the new reality is a completely bogus threat. There's no new reality. No exclusion. It doesn't hold any water whatsoever. It is simply a ridiculous supposition and plausibility. All it is plausibility. If you examine it, you realize there's no, will never be any truth to that. Never. So these are the things I have to keep urging you to keep looking at this, keep looking at this. And even if a little bit of this gets through and you see it, even a little bit anywhere, it's enough. It's enough to say, whoa. It's only enough to say, whoa, you know, no. Say no to sacrifice. Say no to the designs of nature. Say no, you are not, what you are was not created by nature at all. And all the creativity of so-called nature, those are just the effects the mind is churning out. It's the mind that is doing it. And the mind is divine. And the mind is the servant of spirit. So it's the mind that's doing all this. It's not nature. Now, when we say that nature's doing this, we're completely deluded. The truth is, there is no such thing as nature. No such thing. The mind is presenting all of this. There's never been even a speck of what we call nature. Nothing. It's simply the imagination of mind, the play of mind's imagination, imagining a hypothetical scenario. That's all it is. Has there never been a shred of actuality to it? Either. It's always been hypothetical from the very beginning. Just the play of mind is all that it is. And so we can give mind a different play. Right? We choose a different idea, and mind has a different play, and it will present that play to us as well. And when we are moving in that direction to a different play, that's God's grace that is helping us move in that direction, and that too has a certain play to it. All right. So even if you don't understand, you know, if some of the stuff you just can't resonate with, if you just resonate with a little bit of it, it's all that's necessary, a little bit. And you just feel like a little bit of empowerment to tell nature, say, nature, you're not real. You have no authority over me whatsoever. You didn't create me what I am. You can really do nothing for me. You can't make the decision that needs to be made. I have to make it. And you just stand up for yourself a little bit. That's all that it takes. Stand up for yourself a little bit. Others won't do it for you, pretty much, because they're under the delusion that they're guided by nature, that nature is in control, that nature created them. So what can they possibly stand up for except for nature? In other words, they're standing up for whatever nature gives us that we have to accept it as that's our lot. You know, that's our lot. Nature brings death and destruction. Well, that's just our lot because we're, you know, nature created us, so who are we to object to it? What rubbish that is. Absolute rubbish. We don't have to accept anything that nature gives us. That is not our lot at all. Never has been. We're trying to make it so. We're trying to make it so nature has power over the prime creator, power over reality. Because nature has this destructivity to it, right? What of nature has ever escaped the destructivity of nature? Even diamonds eventually, you know, are worn away. Planets, have they escaped? Suns, galaxies, has anything escaped it? No, nothing, nothing, nothing. They say even space and time don't escape it. You know, it cannibalizes itself. It devours itself. Nature devours itself. That's got nothing to do with reality. That is just a wild fantasy that we're having. A hypothetical scenario. Crazy fantasy. Trying to generate, to build a power. A new power of negation that we can then use to threaten the Prime Creator. And you may wonder, how can we apply this? It seems so big picture-ish. Yeah, it's totally applicable because what we're seeing here in this world is the rise of the pagans in this world. They're now in charge of this planet in key positions. When you have a war, you don't necessarily have to occupy all of the land. Let's say you invade a land, a country. You just have to occupy the key parts of it, you know. The key city, the key parts of the city, the transportation, you know, various things that, you know, the outlying countryside might not be directly under your control, but if you control, you can control all the key elements that are necessary. You're in control. And so the pagans are in control of the world right now, even though there's a lot of people in the world who disagree with them. They are actually in control. They have the media under their control. They have the means of distributing news and information under their control. They have the politics under their control. They have the bureaucracy under control. They have the laws under their control. They have the police under their control, the military under their control. All these, the judicial is under their control. All this stuff is under their control. And so, even though there's many people who disagree with it, you know, they're, as far as nature goes, they're powerless. Really, they don't have much power anymore. They don't really have it. They've lost the loss. The war in this world has been lost. Although there are a lot who are, you know, beating their chests and saying, we can win it. It's already too far gone. That is something that people don't yet realize. All because all this has been designed for a long, long time. The blueprints for this go way back. And we don't realize the level of planning that has taken place to bring about this sacrificial event, because it's all important, because it's believed that this will catalyze the hypothetical into an actual. That is why there are beings from all over the universe here now, viewing planet Earth and what's going to happen here. It's all important. They say it's going to save the universe. It's going to help the universe realize its purpose. That what's going to happen to planet Earth as it goes through these travails, that somehow it's going to finish off this whole plan of the universe. Well, that plan, again, is for this power of negation to become a real power. And the planet Earth going through its travails is simply the belief that it will catalyze this. And yet all those beings from all over the universe here watching this planet from different subtle levels and dimensions, and some, you know, in their various vehicles and ways and means they have of traveling, etc. They're here, and they're all here for no, you know, they're going to be totally disappointed. Waste of their time. Purpose of the universe will never be realized. So they might as well go on home, you know. It's not going to benefit them in the slightest bit. Witnessing trauma, destruction, all that stuff doesn't help, doesn't provide the catalyst to turn the hypothetical into the real, the actual. Does not provide it. You can sit there in front of your television all day and all night, forever, being fed images of trauma, which is exactly what the television does feed everybody, doesn't it? Trauma in all different ways, stress in all different ways, threat in all different ways. That's all the television really pumps out, you know, along with some frivolous song and dance to kind of amuse us and then plunge us back into the threat. So we're sitting here watching television. Most people have spent their lives watching television instead of studying the divine truth. And they're hoping that this will, you know, be a catalyst. But you can watch it forever and it won't be a catalyst. You can watch people dying forever and it won't be any different than the situation we're in right now. We've always been in. And that is, doesn't do anything. Doesn't catalyze the hypothetical, which means the hypothetical then just keeps continuing on, doubling down and say, well, the next time it will. And then the next time and the next time and the next time. And you just keep on going around and around and around like a rat in a cage, one of those wheels. The rat doesn't go anywhere. That's all that we're doing in existence, is going around in circles, getting nowhere. And eventually, you know, you wake up and say, wait a minute, I need to assess this. What you do, I need to assess it, because I'm really tired of all this. I don't feel I'm getting what I really want. So something's not right. Let me assess what's not right and just do it with an honest, open mind, and don't rule anything out maybe to start with. Just say, you know, what there's got to be something that's not right. And eventually you'll track it down and you'll find out what's not right. Eventually you do it. You have the capacity to do that. And then you'll see, oh my gosh. Existence is just hypothetical. I've been trying to make, you know, find a way to catalyze it into the real, and I can never succeed with that. Wow. Wow, wow, wow. Then you come out of the darkness, you know, into the light like that. And you drop the blueprints of all this trying to find a catalytic agent. And you realize you don't have to go through any such sacrifice. You don't have to be part of that catalyzing effort, because you know it's doomed to fail from the very beginning. There's no possibility of success. Why do you need to participate in something that where there's no possibility of success and no possibility of anyone succeeding at all? You only will strengthen their belief that, you know, it must succeed, and when it doesn't, that will probably just propel them even to even more greater efforts to make it succeed. You're not doing anyone any favors by going along with sacrifice. What they need to see is those who will not, and they say, wonder why they didn't go along with it. You know, maybe that's the right thing to do. A seed will be planted within them, and they'll say, I wonder if not going along with the sacrificial scenario, I wonder if that's the way to go about it. And eventually that seed will start growing as they start examining, saying, now, wait a minute, you know, is sacrifice really worked? Has it ever worked? No. Will it ever work? I'm not so sure. You know, and at least I know somebody who was convinced that it would never work. And maybe they were right. You know, maybe they were right. So those seeds grow and grow and grow. And yet the world needs those who will turn their back on the world, turn their back on nature, and saying, no, I'm not a child of nature at all. The world needs those who will not go into any sacrificial scenario. Say, forget it. That's needed. And even if people don't see it directly or anything, it's registered on a subtle level. Everything that happens here is registered on a subtle level. So you might say, well, like for instance, this kind of sharing here, you know, there's like, I have like about 144 subscribers, this channel does, and then the views, you know, are like around from anywhere from 40 to 80 views per video. And you might think, well, the sharing is very small. But the truth is, on subtle levels, the sharing is going out everywhere to the whole universe. And so it is being shared there. Everything is shared with everyone. Everything. It's just on subtle levels of energy that we're not quite aware of maybe deeper levels, maybe even spirit is aware of this. So by you turning your back on sacrifice, it even if nobody knows about it through, you know, those people, their perception, you know, they don't pick up a newspaper, they go on the internet and there's some story about such and such turned their back on nature and went somewhere and you know, is now a recluse or something, is not participating in this sacrificial scenario. Even if there isn't any blurb about that, doesn't matter. You're still sharing it with everybody. They're aware of it at some level, and that awareness will, you know, like a bubble, like a cork, it's always rising up toward the surface, and they may push it down and push it down, but it's always rising. It's buoyant. It's inherently buoyant. Truth within us is inherently buoyant. Inherently buoyant. So no matter what we do, no matter how much we try to repress it, it's always rising up. It's always rising up, and the more that truth is accepted, the more buoyancy there is, the more bubbles there are, the more corks there are. And if people see all these corks rising up, they say, "Wow, you know, what's going on here?" There is interest. People have interest, but they disguise it because they're too afraid to be excluded from the new reality, that the hypothetical new reality, the plausible new reality. They're terrified of being excluded from it. But again, there won't be any such reality, new reality. So the fear of exclusion it has no basis in reality whatsoever. And yet people are afraid, so they may not be directly aware of a certain sharing of truth, but deep within them there is some awareness. It's like, you know, radio stations are broadcasting in all over, let's say the area you live. No matter where you drive in that area, you can turn on the radio, and boom, there, the radio station is there. It's there all the time. But if we want to hear it clearly, we need the radio, and then we need to tune into it, right? We need to tune into it. So truth is being broadcast constantly. We just have to turn the radio on and tune into it. But it's still there. That's just an analogy. But people are actually aware. The whole world is aware of everything. So if there's some sharing of truth going on, they're aware of that too. It may want to keep pushing it down for a while because they're worried about being excluded from a new reality. They want to be seen as good, loyal soldiers, soldiering on with this scenario of death and willing to throw themselves into the fire for the purpose of catalyzing this whole scenario into a real power. They're willing to keep soldiering on. That's what will happen in this world. And you don't have to participate at all. You don't have to feel any guilt about not participating. Just the opposite. What you're doing is being massively helpful, even though nobody may admit to that. Doesn't matter. It's being massively helpful. It's lessening delay to a great extent. So it's very justifiable. Just watching these videos is helping the world out vastly. Vastly, because you're saying, "Hey, you know what? I can watch this stuff. It's not that bad. It's just pretty, you know, I kind of enjoy it." People will wonder, "Wow, really? I thought that stuff was like very frightening, terrible." And you say, no, it's not that bad. You can get acclimatized to it. It's just like some people can get acclimatized to eating hot peppers, you know. They eat enough of them, they get to a point where they can, you know, it's still hot, but they can handle it. No problem. They know how to do it. Like that, you can get used to very clear, direct sharing of the way that what's really going on. It may seem a little hot, you know, too hot to handle, but you can handle it. You can get used to it. When you get used to it, you find out it gets easier and easier and easier. A couple things are going on television. The political convention is going on, and a baseball game is going on. I'm not watching either one of them. I'm here doing the taping. See, I'm turning my back on that which presumes to be guided by nature. You gotta remember that the true God is the God of reality, not the God of nature at all. Worshipping the God of nature is worshipping a false God, an imaginary, hypothetical God, which will never become real. Never. It's only a belief. We're worshipping an image, a belief, our own imagination, our own whim, our own decree. We believe that it is so, so we believe that it is so. It's like that. We believe, therefore we believe. There is no God of nature. Nature simply arises. Mind is what mind presents to spirit as a means to become spirit, to become prime creator. And mind says, "Spirit, what we're doing here in existence is developing a power of negation that will be able to destroy reality. That's what we're doing." And so spirit says, "Oh, okay, that's great." Yes, it's believed in, but belief doesn't make anything true or real at all. It does not. So of course, what can mind say except, "Yeah, oh yeah, this is gonna work. Of course, it's gonna work." Has to say that. It's not going to say, Spirit, this will never work. Mind is never going to say that. Can never say that. But spirit is so used to believing in mind, what mind says. Of course, mind has to lie. When spirit said, you know, make me prime creator, but mind couldn't say, no, I can't. Mind said, oh, okay, of course, no problem. It has to say that. It's a perfect servant. Mind is not a negative force. It cannot say no. So it says, sure, no problem, no problem. Well, it says, well, it won't be easy, but eventually you'll succeed. All lies. So mind is just lying to us constantly, saying, sure, you can do it. You're going to do it. It's a fait accompli. It's guaranteed to, it's just going to take a long time, but you're guaranteed to get there. That's a lie. So we're so used to mind now lying to us, which it has to do with this idea, with this impossible idea we gave to it, that we're still used to listening to mind tell us and believing mind. Our belief is invested in what mind is telling us. We're so used to that that we need something that sounds like mind also informing us that the opposite is true, that mind is not telling the truth. But we're so, again, that's why the voice of reason is within us. It sounds like it's mind. It seems like it is mind. And maybe it is mind in the service of a different idea, you see. But we're so used to listening to mind reassure us that any kind of reassurance we get, we need to have it seem like it's coming from mind. We really do. Which is why the voice of reason, the prime creator, placed the voice of reason within our spirit as an aspect of our spirit. And that voice of reason acts just like the mind, except it tells the truth to us instead of lies. Because it knows that the fait accompli is that you're going to choose a new idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator. It knows that is a fait accompli. And therefore, it speaks from that fait accompli position of the new idea, and it relates to you, the new idea, saying, yes, you will do this, and this is why you need to do this, and you have to do it, and here's how to save time, delay, because if it's a fait accompli, all we're doing then is just delaying. And so the voice of reason tells us, here's how you can minimize delay. And yet, for us, it feels just like the mind is informing us. Just like it. Uses the same words, the concepts, everything, except it's telling us the truth. It's telling us that the hypothetical can never be transmuted, never be catalyzed and transmuted into the real, the actual, can never. But again, it uses terms, it uses concepts, and can have like you can have an internal dialogue with the voice of reason, which is what I've done for a long, long time. Just an internal dialogue, just bounce these ideas, you know, have that internal dialogue. Well, what is true? Is this true or not? And just kind of listen, and you'll get some clarifications will just kind of pop into your mind, just like other stuff pops in your mind, like you're driving down to the store or something, and you just suddenly think, huh, I haven't seen that house for a while. I wonder what they have in the store. What's on my grocery list? Stuff will just come in your mind constantly, right? You're aware of that. The voice of reason can also just come into your awareness with its concepts and its what it says. And what it says is true. What it says is true. And again, the mind is not an inherent liar. It simply has to lie to us because it cannot say no to an idea. We said, make us prime creator, and mind said, yes, master, I will do that. It cannot say, no, I can't do that. It cannot do that. It cannot say that. It has no power to oppose. Mind has no power to oppose. So it tells us the lie. It says, oh, of course, we can do that. I'll do that. Not a problem. Not a problem. It's going to require a lot of, you know, a lot of stuff you're not used to. A lot of strange stuff like dying and identifying with bodies and change and impermanence and despair and dark confusion and fear and all these strange, strange stuff. But the mind says, but eventually you'll get there. And the mind knows that's a lie. The mind knows it's a lie. And in some way, you know, it just, I don't know if it knows it's a lie in the way that we would think of it, you know. It's simply mind in its creativity has to function this way, has to put this hypothetical scenario out there and insist that it's a fait accompli, that it's going to succeed. It insists upon it. Has to. Otherwise, we could not entertain this idea of being prime creator at all, even for a moment. Boom, you know, we drop it the instant we even thought about it. But mind has to say, oh yes, as soon as we think about it, mind has to say, it's a fait accompli. That's the first thing that mind has to do. Say, mind, make us prime creator. And mind says, done. It's a done deal. And we go, huh? He says, yeah, it's a fait accompli. I can see it right now. It's already been accomplished. I'm just going to show you how you accomplished it. And it's fait accompli. It's going to happen. No question. Mind has to right away, immediately say that. It has to tell us that. And of course, we don't expect anything less than mind, because any other idea we tell mind, mind says, you know, boom, right away, there it is. So when we told mind, make us prime creator, and there's nothing mind could do except say, yes, it's a done deal. But let me say, well, where is it? And mind says, well, you need to get there. There's a process of getting there. He said that it's already, I can see it's the completion is already there, yet you have to go through a process. So then it tells us all this stuff. You have to evolve. You have a soul, and the soul has to journey through all this time and space and events, and then eventually your soul will, the transmutation will take place, and then your soul will become the new prime creator. And spirit says, oh, wow, really? I didn't know I had a soul. Mind says, oh, yeah, now you do. This is how you got to be prime creator. You need to see how you did it. You know, so like we're looking as spirit, we're kind of looking at existence. It's like we're watching a movie of how did we get to be prime creator, not realizing that there is no end to this movie because we never did get to be prime creator. But mind cannot tell us that, but the voice of reason can tell us that. So we listen to the voice of reason. It tells us that. And so that's what these videos are all about. And we're going to end this video before it gets to be an hour, so maybe some of you can get through it, because it's important to get through these, because I'm trying to just pour out share as much information here as possible. And if I did it like 10-minute segments, there'd be too many videos, you know, too many. So, all right, very great. And that's it for this video.